Hello and welcome to you fire drillers. This is Fire Drill Friday, and I'm so happy to be here with you. Today and every day, this is a space where we're building community, learning about the climate crisis, and taking action to address it. You can join our ever-growing family of fierce fighters at firedrillfridays.com. While we're settling in, don't forget to drop your name and where you're tuning in from in the comments, because I love to hear from you, okay? We'll be delving into the pressing issue of plastics, exploring the profound impact they have on human health and how we can tackle this growing global crisis. We have an incredible lineup of guests, including leading health expert, Dr. Leo Trasande, tireless community mobilizer, Sharon Lavigne, and actor and climate justice advocate, Bonnie Wright, a longtime friend of Greenpeace and our oceans. But before we dive in, let me share a bit of good news directly related to last month's topic, hot labor summer. Six weeks ago, tens of thousands of auto workers boldly took a stand against the big three automakers, General Motors, Ford, and Stellantis. They went on strike with their union, United Auto Workers, to demand better pay, safer working conditions, and a just transition to electric vehicles. One of these workers, Michelle, shared her story on last month's Fire Drill Fridays, shedding light on what's at stake for her family and fellow workers. Their mission was clear: secure new record union contracts to keep pace with the record profits by auto giants. They also set out to inspire workers in the auto industry and beyond to fight for good union jobs and dignity. I am thrilled to report that Michelle and her fellow auto workers achieved a watershed breakthrough in their fight for fair contract. This past week, the UAW reached historic tentative agreements with the big three automakers. They secured significant wage increases, the reinstatement of major benefits lost during the Great Recession, as well as agreements that workers in their future electric vehicle battery factories could be included in this upcoming contract. These wins are absolutely huge and will help pressure and ensure that workers don't have to choose between a good job and a green job. As we highlighted last month, when workers and their allies unite and win, it ignites hope and inspires further action. UAW auto workers have shown that better working conditions and a just transition to electric vehicles is possible if we fight for it together, united. But it's not over yet. The workers have a final say. They will be voting on whether to accept this contract or continue to strike in the weeks to come. Until then, we send hearty congratulations to the auto workers for their courage and sacrifice, and to all of you firefighters who rallied in solidarity. Thank you. Okay, now let's delve into plastics. Plastics are everywhere. They're convenient, they're cheap, and unfortunately, they're also harming us in ways we're just beginning to understand. For a long time, we've known the harm flat plastic inflicts on our planet and our oceans. We've seen turtles and seabirds and seals die and suffer from ingesting or getting strangled in plastic. Maybe you've heard of the Great Pacific Garbage Patch, made up of immense collection of trash and microplastics spanning waters from the west coast of the United States all the way to Japan. Maybe you've heard how plastics created from fossil fuels are becoming a significant driver of climate change. As if all of that weren't bad enough, it's now becoming abundantly clear that plastics are dangerous for us as well, our bodies and our overall health. Plastics are in the food we eat, the water we drink, the air we breathe. Microplastics have been found in our blood, our lungs, and even our hearts. One study estimates that on average, people eat 5 grams of plastic every single week. That's about the weight of a credit card. I mean, think about that. We are ingesting an entire credit card's worth of plastic each and every week. Even more distressing is the discovery that plastics have been found in placentas and breast milk, meaning babies are exposed to toxic microplastics before they're even born and in their earliest days of life. It's truly heartbreaking. Of the more than 13,000 chemicals that are used to make plastics, about a quarter of them have been linked to health effects, such as cancer, nervous system issues, and hormonal disruptions, which are also connected to heart disease and birth defects. Plastic hurts us throughout its entire life cycle, from the oil and gas extraction needed to produce these materials that our climate just can't afford, to the poisoning of communities near plastic manufacturing plants, leading to higher rates of cancer and asthma. Then comes the chemicals that infiltrate our bodies from plastic packaging, ultimately ending with plastic littered or dumped in nature, killing wildlife and polluting our soils and our water. And all that for what? For what? A throwaway water bottle? A shopping bag? A plastic-wrapped produce? I mean, how does this make any sense? You know, I grew up before plastic existed, and we did just fine with wax paper, with glass, with wood, with tin. We don't need plastic, especially single-use plastic. For decades, we've lived under the illusion that recycling could save us from plastic pollution. But a recent report from Greenpeace USA revealed the stark reality. Only 5% of plastic in the United States are currently being recycled. And it turns out that the relatively small amount of plastics that are recycled contain higher levels of toxicity than virgin plastic. Bottom line, we cannot recycle our way out of the plastics crisis. We have to stop it at its source. Now, this may seem daunting, but history has shown that change is possible, okay? Change is possible if we work together. Many of you are familiar with asbestos, you know, which was once everywhere, in our homes, in our cars, in our clothing. In the early 1970s, asbestos use hit an all-time high, millions of metric tons per year. However, it was discovered to be highly toxic, harming human health whenever the fibers were inhaled. Awareness of these hazards grew, and people began to speak out and organize, including labor and trade unions, advocating for safe working conditions. And by the late 70s, asbestos use had declined dramatically. Today, 17 countries have banned it, and many more, including the U.S., have imposed strict limits on its use. This is a testament to what's possible when people wake up and demand action. Plastics are the new asbestos, and we must act swiftly to curb production before the crisis escalates. The good news is our world governments can step in and protect us. In just over a week, leaders from around the globe will come together to discuss a global plastics treaty. This marks the third round of negotiations, and the hope is that they will reach a decision by the end of 2024. We have a once-in-a-generation opportunity to halt the inundation of senseless, single-use plastics into our environment and our bodies. I remember the world before plastics became part of our daily lives, and I hope to see a world after single-use plastics. I promise you, it's not only possible, but it ain't so bad to not have single-use plastics in our life. We can just do just fine without them. In this absolutely pivotal moment, we need to urge President Biden to take a strong stance on the Global Plastics Treaty. You can sign the treaty by visiting, it's a petition actually, you can sign it by visiting firedrillfridays.com/takeaction today. Now, I'm sure you're just as eager as I am to hear from our esteemed guests, and they're coming. But before I welcome them, I want to share a sneak peek at the new documentary, We Are All Plastic People Now. It's set to premiere in January. Notably, two of our guests today are featured in this documentary, and it's narrated by my good friend, Ted Danson.
Hi, I'm Ted Danson. I'm excited to introduce to you this new film regarding one of our planet's greatest threats, plastic.
Yes, the blood kit has arrived.
If there is plastic coursing through my veins, then probably there is plastic in most of us. That's
the way it is. Let me tell you something about plastic. Plastics are everywhere.
For humanity, plastic is the end of the future.
We're at a crossroads. Plastic is probably one of our greatest achievements, but probably our biggest enemy.
Plastics are in our saliva, in our urine, in our blood, and they're even present in babies at birth.
Microplastics have found their way to the home of an unborn baby.
The problem is the future, but people usually are blind to the future.
All those chemicals makes me sick. I cannot live here, not anymore.
These plastic chemicals literally contaminate our bodies.
The sperm count had declined dramatically over the prior 50 years.
It'd be interesting to take a brain of someone with Alzheimer's disease and look and see if, you know, what if there's plastic there too?
We're seeing rates of colon cancer increase dramatically.
People are dying. People are dying rapidly.
An 18-wheeler is barreling toward you, you step aside. We will certainly learn about the make and model of the 18-wheeler, but we don't want to do that while we're under it.
Not only do we have the current amount of plastic that's out there, but they want to, in fact, triple the amount of that.
This is an experiment in which we did not consent.
It's alarming, to say the least, but let's remember, change is possible.
In the blood that was submitted to us, so far, in the time we have analyzed and found.
Looks intriguing, right? I must say, rather alarming, though. But remember, knowledge is power. So mark your calendars for the release of We Are All Plastic People Now this January. And today we're in for a real treat as we have a distinguished panel of leading experts and activists engaged in the plastic fight. Let me kick things off with a warm welcome to Dr. Leo Trasande, director of the New York University Langone Center for the Investigation of Environmental Hazards. He is an internationally renowned leader in environmental health, with research focused on the impacts of chemicals on hormones in our bodies. He has led the way in documenting the economic costs for policymakers of failing to prevent diseases of environmental origin proactively. Welcome, Leo. I'm so glad you're here.
Thanks for having me.
Next, we have Sharon Lavigne, a true force of nature. She is to be reckoned with. The daughter of civil rights activists, Sharon grew up living off the land in St. James Parish, Louisiana, and worked as a special education teacher. When a billion-dollar plastics manufacturing plant threatened her community, Sharon transformed into a powerhouse activist and founded Rise St. James, a faith-based grassroots environmental organization. She mobilized her community to successfully halt the construction of this plastic plant, which would have produced 1 million pounds of liquids, hazardous waste, each year. In 2021, Sharon won the most prestigious Goldman Environmental Prize for her incredible accomplishments. Glad to have you here with us, Sharon. And I'm delighted, I'm Very delighted to have actor, writer, and climate justice advocate Bonnie Wright making her return to the Fire Drill Friday show. You might remember her best as the actress playing Ginny Weasley in all 8 of the Harry Potter films, but Bonnie has since stepped behind the camera, directing shorts, commercials, and music videos with projects that have premiered at Cannes and Tribeca Film Festival. Bonnie is a passionate advocate for ocean health and its links to our own health. She wrote a book called Go Gently, Actionable Steps to Nurture Yourself and the Planet, that explores practical and tangible ways we can take action for our environment and community. Bonnie is also an ambassador with Greenpeace, Kiss the Ground and Choose Love. Hi, Bonnie. Welcome back.
Thank you.
Each of you brings such unique stories and perspectives to this fight. I'd love to hear from every one of you about how you got involved. But Bonnie, I want to start with you. You've previously shared how you first became an activist around ocean protection. Tell us how your activism evolved as you connected the dots and how stopping plastics has become so important to you.
Yeah, sure. When I was a teenager, I spent a lot of my childhood on a specific beach on the south coast of England, and I was beginning to see so much more pollution in my short lifetime at that moment, beginning to pollute the beaches. And I was always someone who liked to understand how things worked, which I guess I later realized is kind of systems thinking and trying to really look behind, you know, the pollution on the beach and kind of go back in the steps and figure out how it got there. And was it my fault and people's fault, or was it a systems, you know, error? And I basically learned to realize it's both. It's both us as individuals and obviously the wider system. And I became very interested in essentially waste and how that kind of moves around the world. And that led me really to understand single-use plastic pollution and its massive detriment to ocean's health and that how that links to our health. And it really was the opportunity actually to go on a trip with Greenpeace back in 2017 that I feel like really kind of brought together and galvanized my passion to the subject, just from, you know, taking it out of my individual worry and curiosity to me realizing that I could have a part in changing this, and that there were all these amazing, inspiring campaigners, such as the ones at Greenpeace, that I could really learn from and really learn from on that trip I took in 2017. And I've kind of been passionate ever since.
Great. Have you ever seen the animated film called The Story of Stuff that was made by Annie Leonard, who used to run Greenpeace?
Yes, I have. Yeah. And she has a book too, right? The Story of Stuff, her book. Yeah.
Leo, coming from the medical field, can you share how you transitioned from being a pediatrician, you know, caring for kids, to becoming a leader in environmental health? I mean, specifically how did you connect the dots from medicine to the plastic crisis?
Well, the average doctor still to this day gets between 1 and 3 hours of education about environmental hazards in the entirety of medical school, less than a heart procedure case that is pretty much the staple of the average medical student. I had a strong interest in health policy and had gotten a master's in public policy from the Kennedy School of Government. And I had capital fever, if you will. So I had the opportunity to go spend a year after my pediatrics residency working for then Senator Hillary Rodham Clinton. And I was told to go work on children's and environmental health issues. I figured I had the child health part down pat, and I figured I'd learn the environmental health piece on the way. But boy, was I in for a surprise. I realized how broad the impacts are of chemicals in the environment, particularly those from plastic, and their impacts on human health. And they affect all of us, to be perfectly honest. It's not just a pediatric issue, it's a human health issue. And so that set me up for a career now spanning nearly 20 years, looking at the effects, particularly in children and pregnant women.
Well, you know, I was diagnosed last year with cancer. It's now in remission, but that experience of having cancer, and I did quite a bit of research, made me realize how much cancer-causing things are in our environment. There's plastics and also you know, the forever chemicals and a lot of other things. And I was so disturbed by the extent to which the medical community doesn't look at those things, you know, deals with cure. And I'm here to testify. I'm very grateful about that, but not so much prevention. So I'm really grateful to you that you gained that understanding and then kind of made a shift in your focus. And I hope it becomes contagious, what you did. I have a question now for you, Sharon. You spent most of your working life as a special education teacher, but then shifted gear to become a fiercely dedicated environmental justice advocate. What was it that sparked such a profound life change?
First of all, when I joined an organization in 2015, I listened to the members of that organization talk about the industries in St. James that I didn't know how many we had. I didn't know anything about that. I didn't know anything about the environment. And so I sat there for 2.5 years and I listened to what they said. And one of them said, we might have to move because we have so many industries in St. James. And I went and I counted, and we counted 12 within a 10-mile radius. Then another one wanted to come in 2018. That's when the governor announced it. And then I went into prayer. I was devastated to know that it's a possibility that I might have to move, me and my family. And I didn't know where I was going to move or what. So when I went into prayer, I asked God what I should do, if I should sell my home, if I should sell my land. And to my surprise, he said no. I was getting ready to look for a place to move to. When he said no, I asked him, what should I do? And he said, fight. I had no idea what to fight, how to do, or what to do. So he put a fight in me to stop Formosa Plastics and any other industry that tries to come into St. James Parish. I started in 2018. 2019, I had to retire from teaching because I couldn't do 2 full-time jobs and be effective. And I was tired because I was working 2 jobs. So I retired in October of 2019. And look like this, it just flew, that God is the pilot and we are the passengers. And we lobbied, we formed our organization. We got with other organizations. We formed a coalition against Death Alley. And we marched. We went to the governor's mansion to talk to him, but he wouldn't come out. We went to his office to talk to him. He went out the back door. And none of the politicians wanted to help us. Our parish officials, they wouldn't help us fight this industry. So it was a fight that was put in me that I can't explain. And we've been going ever since.
God bless. I find answers through prayer and meditation too, Sharon. I totally understand. Thank you for that inspiring story. I'm looking forward to visiting you in person. And you know, for those of you who don't know, I'm working with Greenpeace and leaders like Sharon to document and film the environmental injustices that are completely wreaking havoc in the Gulf South communities and are threatening our planet. I mean, people have no idea the horrors that are happening down there. I'm so grateful to you, Sharon. You're all going to be hearing a lot more about it in the coming year, so stay tuned. But okay, let's get deeper into exploring the specific health impacts of plastics. Leo, as a leader in environmental health and research, how would you summarize the most alarming health effects of plastics?
Well, the issue here is that chemicals used in plastic materials hack our hormones. Hormones are our basic signaling molecules underlying basically any biological function you can think of: temperature, metabolism, salt, sugar, and even sex. And when you hack those natural signaling molecules by throwing into the mix synthetic chemicals that look often a lot like the hormones in our bodies, it's perhaps no surprise that you can have a broad and wide-scale impact. So just to talk about the chemicals for a minute, we're talking about the forever chemicals you talked about, PFAS, nonstick chemicals used mostly in oil and water resistant clothing and nonstick pans, but that's a fluoropolymer, it's a plastic. Phthalates used in food packaging, they make plastic more bendable. bisphenols used in aluminum can linings. That aluminum can lining, if you take off the aluminum, there's a plastic lining underneath. And then we have a host of flame retardants that we know are used in furniture and electronics. And ultimately, the vast majority of them come because they're plastics in origin. We can go through a large array of the consequences for human health as we go here today.
As a pediatrician, are there specific implications that you're most worried about for children and their development?
Unfortunately, there's a lot going on here. We know that phthalates, for example, shrink babies' growth so that they don't have as high a birth weight. And what that does is sets a cascade of things going on in the human body for long-term metabolism. The body responds by adapting and taking all the calories in a more effective way and preserving them ultimately as fat, storing them for a later day when another nutritional or other insult happens. And so what we're talking about here is a setup for obesity, diabetes, and even heart disease in adults. We know that 100,000 American people die each year from phthalate exposure in adulthood, even on top of childhood. And then there's a frightening thought, which is the genital development, particularly of boys, but also of girls, can be affected. There's an anatomical distance low in the body called anogenital distance that it's too short. And as a result of being too short, produces decreases in sperm count, among other consequences. So when we talk about the declining sperm count and increases in infertility we've seen across the US population and worldwide, you can put a fair bit of it, not all of it, on chemicals, especially those used in plastics.
Wow. And if I'm not mistaken, a lot of these chemicals are carried in fat, and women have more fat than men, right?
That's right. And breast milk can be another vehicle
right.
for transmission at a particularly important window of development. Look, I'm a pediatrician, and I'm going to tell you every time breast is best, right? But the fact is that we want to prevent the contamination in the first place.
Right. Thank you. Wow. Sharon, as a community mobilizer and activist in Louisiana, you witnessed some really acute and serious health impacts of plastics, specifically within the communities suffering the brunt of toxic exposure from plastics production. What are the most concerning impacts you see in your community?
Oh, so many people in my community are getting sick, especially with cancer. And so many people are dying with cancer. I can name my neighbor on one side of me had throat cancer, one on the other side had bone cancer. And I just lost one of my dear friends, Mac. He had stage 4 bone cancer. He fought this for 10 years. And now I have my friend, Norma Jean, that's my classmate. She has liver cancer. There's a whole slew of people around me that has cancer. And my two brothers have cancer, but thank God they're still here. My sister-in-law died with breast cancer. And so many people are glad that we're fighting this fight to help stop all of these chemical buildouts. If we could stop all of these buildouts and people that's coming in here polluting us, I think we would have longer lives over here in St. James. People are crying for help. And I didn't know so many people had cancer until we started this fight. They came out of the closet to let us know that they had cancer. And it's a fight.
Are you able, Sharon, are you able to go to your local or statewide elected officials and get them to help you?
I tried that. And they are in the pockets of industry. Mm. Especially our local parish council person that's in my district. We have 7 districts. The one in I'm in the 5th district. He's in the 5th district. He's our council person. He will not help us fight. He was in the pockets of Formosa Plastics. We voted him out on October 14th, and we have a new council person that's coming in January.
Great. Thank you, Sharon. Thanks for sharing. I'm so sorry this is happening. It's clear the health impacts are just devastating every step of the life cycle of plastics. So let's talk about ways we can reduce plastic consumption. Bonnie, you wrote Go Gently, which is a book about how we can live more sustainably across every aspect of our lives, from food to shopping to how we nurture ourselves and our activism. Could you share some, give us some practical tips to help us reduce our reliance on plastic in our daily lives?
Yeah, sure. I feel like, I mean, you mentioned it a little bit before how there has been a world not too long ago where we didn't have single-use plastic. So I do think a lot of the actions we can take is not about reinventing the wheel. It's really about looking to our past as systems that did work for us, that essentially were a more sort of reusable model. There were a closed loop model where things weren't for convenience and we kind of held a to-go coffee cup for 3 seconds, drank the coffee and then in the trash or, you know, recycling if we know that ever happens. So my book is really about sort of looking to essentially our more resourceful nature that we all have within us to be more mindful of the things that we buy, to really seek transparency behind the brands that we buy from, and seeing where we're kind of sold this idea of conveniency and highly processed foods as a kind of way to feed capitalism and not our own health. So really, how can we sort of, you know, look at more whole ingredients when we're looking at the food we cook? How can we have our reusable cups and containers and utensils when we can? And how to can we fix and tend and mend to what we already have rather than always seeking new things? So even if that's a small skill of learning how to sew something back together or mending an electronic, you know, things have become so cheap sometimes that you just replace them. But like, what does that really, you know, do for us? And also noticing sort of within that, how can you bring your community into that so it becomes a more collective and fun experience rather than a kind of daunting, scary task? And yeah, my book is really full of practical sort of recipes and tips. And I really try to stress in the book, there's no right or wrong way to do anything. There's so much more nuance to that and gray area in the sense of our accessibility individually is so different. So just finding a way that works for you and your lifestyle, and it doesn't have to be all day, every day. It's kind of when you can to not feel even more of a burden of feeling like, you know, you're not enough.
Thank you for that. You know, I have a four-year-old. I have two grandkids in college and then a four-year-old grandchild. So I'm starting to think about Christmas. And it suddenly occurred to me, you know, when I was little, our toys were all wooden and they were great. And there are places where you can get wooden children's toys now. And I encourage everybody to look into that. Leo, I have another question for you from a medical standpoint. Do you have advice to add on how we can mitigate health risks from plastics in our personal lives and with our kids or grandkids in my case?
Sure. There are safe and simple steps that neither require a PhD in chemistry nor have to break the bank. So when we're talking about plastic specifically, we're talking especially about not microwaving or machine dishwashing plastic. There are chemicals that are not directly bound to the plastic itself that, particularly with heat and certain conditions, absorb directly into food when you subject them to that kind of pressure and insult. And if the plastic is obviously etched or scratched, it's time to get rid of it altogether. Now, I agree with what everyone said. We need to reduce our use of plastic. If I'm on an airplane, I'm bringing my stainless steel container, I'm filling it up with water after I clear TSA, and I'm getting on the plane and hydrating that way typically. And particularly, we can also look at the recycling number on plastic. There are some worse plastics than others. 3, 6, and 7 are the ones to avoid. Excuse me. 3 is for phthalate, PVC, phthalates in particular. 6 is for styrene, a known carcinogen. And 7 includes those bisphenols I talked about near the top. And when it comes to nonstick cooking materials, there's cast iron, there's stainless steel. Last I checked, a little bit of olive oil wasn't bad for you. So those are some very quick and easy steps to reduce your plastic body burden. And those have been proven in high income as well as low income studies. So when people tell me this is only a bougie thing to do or something that the well-to-do can only manage, that's not true.
Great. Thank you so much. Those are invaluable tips, and I'll certainly be trying to follow them. And of course, it's clear that while individual action is important, it's ultimately not enough to solve this crisis, right? Bonnie, from your perspective and your activism with Greenpeace, what steps can people take to hold corporations accountable and push for systemic change?
Yeah, definitely. I think we can't end our individual actions. It'll definitely leave you feeling pretty lonely and frustrated still. I think it's great to have some foundations that make you feel more kind of confident. But from my experience, I think the best thing you can do is to find community in this too, and find your people to do it and not do it alone. So whether that, for instance, could be finding like a local chapter of Greenpeace in your area, it could be maybe an online group if you more prefer that, and essentially seeing on a both local and national and global way, like what policies can you get involved in, such as like the global plastics treaty you're talking about, learning from great wins like the Global Oceans Treaty recently, and really realizing that it's not on us. You know, we're so told that it's our fault and we should be making better choices, and we're constantly kind of fed this idea that we should feel bad for the choices we're making. But there's only so many, there's always going to be walls we've kind of come up against in our individual action where there aren't better options for us to choose the wooden toys or, you know, the stainless steel pans. There are some things that we're just given no other options to. And that's where I often see, like, that's a red flag to realize it's a systems problem. So if you're beginning to sort of change actions in your day-to-day life, and you're finding this one thing near impossible to find an alternative of, that's usually a systems issue that you can maybe use as your inspiration to see, like, does a brand have to change to allow this to happen? Does a policy have to change? And I think we're all led often by incentives. And so I'm very interested in how can corporations and governments create more incentives for individuals to make better choices, such as, bringing your own bag to the grocery store, like rather than saving 10 cents, what if you got 10 cents? You know, these kind of like models that we could work towards that could create more incentives for us. Demand transparency behind the politicians that you support, the brands that you support. And there are great brands out there too, all the time, that are existing and creating new, better products for us. So, you know, your money and where you spend it is also part of kind of your voting power too.
Yeah, good point. Thank you. Very useful. And now for you, Sharon, you have experience going up against huge corporations. You have stopped the construction of a $1 billion plastics manufacturing plant, threatening the health of your community. What lessons did you learn about organizing to win against huge corporations that profit at the expense of our health?
First of all, education. I had to educate myself, then educate the public. We had people in the organization that walked the streets with flyers explaining about what's going on in our community. We also went to social media. We also went to my church to make announcements whenever we have something going on. I also wanted to get connected with the pastors. They don't seem to be interested too much. But one of the priests by the name of Father Vincent Dufresne, he experienced Formosa coming into St. John the Baptist Parish way back in the 1990s. He came on board with us. He was right there with us to help us. But the first thing is education. That's the first thing we did. We did our research on Formosa. We also went to Taiwan to speak to the shareholders this year, that just back in May. They listened to our concerns, but they didn't give us any feedback until this day. Mm-hmm. And we have to get people involved. We have to, first of all, make them understand how we're being impacted. If Formosa plastic would come 2 miles from my home, we would not live. That's like would be a death sentence for us, because we already have 12 within a 10-mile radius, and this was going to be another plant with 14 inside of the big complex. And they want to ignore for an answer. We filed a lawsuit against Formosa and Louisiana Department of Environmental Quality. They appealed it. So now we're going to court on the 7th, the appellate court in Baton Rouge, to listen to the oral arguments. Louisiana Department of Environmental Quality, they're supposed to be protecting us, but they are protecting Formosa Plastics. I think that's wrong. They are supposed to be protecting the people that live here. They are not. So I feel in my heart that we're going to win. And if we don't win this time, we're going to continue until Formosa is not here and no more industry coming to 5th District in St. James Parish.
Boy, from your mouth to God's ear. Do you have trouble sometimes with the members of the community who are working for Formosa? Worried about job loss?
Some of the members that's working in industry come to us and tell us we are doing a good job. And they tell us about the dangers in there. But they say they have to feed their families. And I really understand they need a job. But we want clean jobs. We want jobs that's not going to poison us and not take 25 years off of our lives. And the people that work in mostly in these industries are from out of state. And the reason why we know they're from out of state, whenever they leave the parking lot at the end of the day, the driver's license plate on the back say Mississippi, Texas, Tennessee, all these different places. So we have very few people in St. James who get these jobs. We get the sickness and the debts. They get the money and go somewhere else and spend their money. And we don't have any more stores where they could spend the money in St. James because the industry have bought out so many of the stores and so many people had to leave because of industry. They closed our school. Koch Brothers bought our school, our high school that I was working at when they sold our high school. They closed our post office. They closed our sugar mill, first thing with the sugar mill. And we didn't know why our sugar mill was being closed. Then 10 years later, we find out it's for industry. It's really sad. They're whittling down our community because they plan to build more industry within the 5th District of St. James Parish. And we're not going to allow it.
Oh, Sharon, I'm so sorry. And I'm so grateful that you're as brave as you are. Are there ways that people across the nation or even the world can support frontline communities like yours and help us all move towards living beyond plastics? What can we do?
Bring me to President Biden. I can talk to him myself. When I finish talking to him, he's either going to come down here or he's going to stop this and declare this a climate emergency. Put it on the website. For most, President Biden need to come to St. James Parish and see the impact that we're going through in our community and help us to save our lives. People up there in Washington, they don't know what's going on over here. Once they come and they see it, oh, they can't believe it. Like our administrator, Michael Regan, he said it touched his heart. He didn't know it was that bad. He said hearing about it is one thing, but seeing it is a whole different story.
I'll try to help you get to Washington and try to help you meet with the president or someone close to him. I commit myself to that, Sharon.
Thank you.
Leah, what role do you see for medical and public health professionals in the movement for a plastics-free future?
I'd be delighted to answer that, but I want to add some numbers to support what Sharon's describing because, you know, ultimately industries profit and people are paying. We're all paying because of this. So endocrine disrupting chemicals cost the United States $340 billion dollars a year in health consequences, ranging from early birth to effects on cancer to obesity, you name it, it's in that list. And that was just based on less than 5% of the known chemicals that disrupt hormones. A subset of diseases due to the few chemicals we studied, and a subset of the cost due to the few diseases due to the few chemicals we studied. That was a mouthful. It's all to say it's a really strong underestimate, and it's 2% of the gross domestic product. So when we hear all this stuff of, oh, it's going to hurt jobs or it's going to do, that's nonsense, because there are costs that we're paying and we're passing money to a company that's profiting on the backs of all of us, particularly in frontline communities. And so that's why we as medical organizations like the Endocrine Society, the American Academy of Pediatrics, so many other organizations are really stepping up, putting the message out loud and clear. The Endocrine Society is going to have a large delegation in Nairobi at the third meeting of the Global Plastics Treaty. And our emphasis is particularly on the reduce part of the three R's. The reuse and recycle R's are really just not working at all. We're seeing an exponential production increase, particularly in low and middle income countries where there isn't the same environmental protection agency. So these industries are running roughshod over people who are back at square one and having to advocate for themselves. That's just, that's wrong.
Yeah.
It's racist too, but it's wrong.
Yeah.
And so the leadership of these medical organizations really gives me a lot of hope. And there also are medical organizations, we use plastics in our products. Those are essential uses, but we're even working to reduce the plastic footprint, just like we're reducing the climate footprint. So there's a project, Green Health, working with Healthcare Without Harm. It's really showing a lot of leadership in this space and trying to also do our own part on behalf of human health.
Yeah. You mentioned Healthcare Without Harm. I love that organization. They, you know, this is not the first thing that has been seen for the dangers that it is and gotten rid of. Mercury thermometers and blood pressure, incinerators, all these things that hospitals and doctors used to use that we don't anymore because they were proven to be harmful. We can do this if we work together. And Healthcare Without Harm is a great organization. Bonnie, how do you envision a world beyond single-use plastics? What would it look like if governments, corporations, and communities work to create refill and reuse systems accessible and convenient for everybody? What would it look like?
I feel like there's a term I love, radical imagination. I feel like really imagining the future that you want and not stopping at kind of, don't let your sort of pessimism, stop your imagination. Imagine sort of the best, because we deserve that. And so for me, like using my radical imagination to imagine that future, it essentially is a system that is built with the community in mind, you know, models like cooperatives and different things like that. Like when we come to look at our containers and vessels that we have to sort of like have transactions with and through, how can they be systems that give people jobs, the delivery of those, you know, foods or items, and become really part of your sort of, as a citizen, you show up to use those systems. You know, we can have these systems put in place, but until we actually use them, they can't be kind of successful models. So even just the idea of, like you were saying earlier, like taking a reusable bottle through the airport and really utilizing those water fountains that have been put in place, so they shown to be used and successful and loved, so that they keep spreading across the country and the world. So for me, it just seems like, you know, just imagining, like when I was a kid, there was still the truck that would come by with the glass bottles of milk and the bread, and they'd be delivered to your door. And then you'd put your glass bottle back on the doorstep and it'd be taken away and you got, you know, your milk again. And, you know, does that mean we have to sort of simplify the products that we like to buy? Maybe. And that's not necessarily a bad thing. And really, how can we reinvest it back into our local economy too? So a big thing that I always push is like, how can we buy food that's seasonal and therefore local to us? We've become like, our taste buds have become very global, but how do we kind of really invest in our local flora and fauna for what we like decide to eat? I'm imagining the kind of the milk truck come by, and knowing my farmers, knowing the people that are providing me with my food and how I nurture myself.
Oh, those are great visions. Great.
Yes.
Thank you so much. And thank all of you for your insight and guidance. It was an incredibly informative discussion. And it was, this is going to stay with me, and I hope with our audience. All of you, keep up the great work. I'll look forward to working with you in the future, a future beyond plastics. We know there are solutions. We know there are and alternatives to single-use plastics, systems we can create and invest in to eliminate excessive and unnecessary plastics. But we need governments to hold companies accountable, to spur change and innovation. And that's why we're calling for a global plastics treaty that puts a legally binding cap on plastics, reducing production by at least 75% by 2040. Our health and our environment cannot settle for less. Unfortunately, the current U.S. stance on plastic reduction isn't where it needs to be. You know the drill, firefighters. To make change, we have to take action. So please join me in calling on the Biden administration to support a strong global plastics treaty aligned with the demands of science and justice. Visit firedrillfridays.com/takeaction to sign the petition for a strong global plastics treaty now. Thank you, firefighters, for joining us today. And I'll see you back here next month on the first Friday, December 1st at 11 a.m. Pacific, 2 p.m. Eastern. We'll discuss how the battle to stop climate change and hold polluters accountable is unfolding in the courts. California's Attorney General Rob Bonta will join to give us the inside scoop on California's landmark lawsuit, suing the five biggest oil companies for decades of lies and deception. It's going to be a fascinating discussion. I can't wait to see you then. Thanks for joining me.
Thank you.